Surviving Ophelia by Cheryl Dellasega, PhD. Don't waste your sorrows. Let God use them for your good and His glory. Anne Graham Lotz. Acknowledgements. This is not the book I imagined I would write someday, but the call to create it was unmistakable. Each step of the way, help has come to me through an incredible number of people who offered encouragement, support, prayers, and hugs. Most notably, my husband, Paul, and youngest son, Joe, were intimately involved in the day-to-day cheerleading and hand-holding that made it possible for me to persevere. My other son, Matt, knew the exact right time to come home from the Navy after a year away, reminding me always to take time for what really counts. My incredible agent, Laureen Rowland, has, like many of the women in this book, become a valued friend and supporter. Marnie Cochran, my wonderful editor at Perseus, another mom, and the entire sales publicity team she has connected me with have all been phenomenal in their own ways. Two other people who helped make this book happen were Sue Horstick, my typist and source of initial feedback, and Maureen Earle, a mentor, friend, mom, who voluntarily edited the manuscript, not once, but twice. I cannot describe in a few sentences the contribution of four people who helped Ellen and me by always believing in the best of her. Dr. Shauna Brent, caseworker Amy Davis, Dr. Richard Levine, and high school guidance counselor Frank Basehor, my own therapist, Dr. Barbara Kulengel, who is a psychiatrist, mother, and friend, also kept me going, as did the friends at Harrisburg Quaker Meeting and the community of sojourners at Oasis Ministries. Lastly, I thank the incredible women who opened their lives and hearts, sharing stories of deeply personal struggles. Although most of us have never met face to face, I feel a bond with them that is both mystical and powerful. And to Ellen, I'm sorry it had to be this way. I know it helps that you, like me, will reach many others through the hard times of your life. Introduction. There are no pictures of me cuddling Ellen to my heart for the first time in the delivery room, but it doesn't matter. Every detail is clear in my mind. Her perfect round face, the fuzz of soft gold hair crowning the very top of her head, and her dazed dark eyes squinting against the glare of the bright, sterile lights. "You are the daughter I have always dreamed of," I whispered, resting my cheek against the smooth skin of her forehead. Lying there with her on my chest, I had a vision of the future and all the things she would accomplish. Like a movie on fast forward, I saw her doing well in school, having loyal friends, and being a kind person. She would go to a good college and would someday make a positive difference in this world. Mostly, I pictured all the good times we would have together. The year after her birth, 1984, was probably the happiest one of my life. I had a 5-year-old son, Matt, from my first marriage, who readily adapted to his role as big brother, a great second husband, a job teaching at a small university that I liked, and Ellen. When our youngest son, Joe, was born 18 months after her, I rejoiced again, thrilled she would have a sibling close to her age. "What a pleasant baby," was the most frequent comment I heard during Ellen's early years. It was true. She rarely cried and had an unusual laugh that would start deep in her throat and bubble out, drawing smiles from everyone around her. When I cuddled her, she would often pat my back while I patted hers. The developmental tasks I labored over with Matt and Joe came easily to her. She even decided to stop sucking her thumb on her own, doing so in only a few weeks. My prediction about her academic abilities proved right. She loved math. There are always right answers, and brought home A's in that and other major subjects. All the sports her brothers tried, she tried, as well as dance lessons. Swimming was the activity that stuck, partly because it helped her asthma, and partly because she was good at it. When her arm was broken in third grade, she wore a waterproof sleeve, still competed, and even finished near the top. What touched me most about Ellen was her kindness. She and her brothers had a special sensitivity for kids who were handicapped or didn't quite fit in for some reason. When holidays rolled around, she was the child who diligently saved.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.